Amen.
May the peace of Christ be yours in abundance.
And with your spirit.
Christ came to bring fire on the earth, to purify the fire of God's love, of God's truth. And it cost him his life to kindle that fire. As we gather as church to celebrate his death and resurrection in the Eucharist, we ask that we will experience that same fire within our hearts.
Sisters and brothers, to prepare ourselves for this liturgy, let us rid ourselves of every burden and sin that clings to us.
Lord Jesus, you came to set the earth on fire, yet we let our zeal die out. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you endured the cross for us, and yet we grow weary and lose heart. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the leader and perfecter of faith, and yet we fail to keep our eyes fixed on you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us. In the name of the love he bears for his Son, Jesus Christ, forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Father, your Son, Jesus, wanted to light a fire on earth. Fire of true faith and pure love. Help us then to catch fire at his different diseases, to share the good news that you are our Father, and that your Son is the Lord of life, and that the Spirit is the cause of our joy, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. In those days, the princes said to the king, Jeremiah ought to be put to death. He is demoralizing the soldiers who are left in the city, and all the people, by speaking such things to them. He is not interested in the welfare of our people, but in their ruin. King Zedekiah answered, he is in your power. For the king could do nothing with them. And so they took Jeremiah and threw him into the cistern of the prince of Malchiah, which was in the quarters of the guard, letting him down with ropes. There was no water in the cistern, only mud, and Jeremiah sank to the ground. Ebed-Melech, a court official, went there from the palace and said to him, my lord king, these men have been at fault, and all they have done to the prophet Jeremiah, casting him into the cistern. He will die of famine on the spot, for there is no more food in the city. Then the king ordered Ebed-Melech to the Tushite to take three men along with him, and draw the prophet Jeremiah out of the cistern before he should die. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you.
reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us rid ourselves of each burden and sin that clings to us, and persevere in running the race that lies before us, while keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus, the leader, the perfecter of faith. For the sake of the joy that lay before him, he endured the cross, despising its shame, and has taken his seat at the right of the throne of God. Consider how he endured with such opposition from sinners, in order that you may not grow weary and lose heart. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood. The word of the Lord.
From now on, a household of five will be divided, three against two, and two against three. A father will be divided against his son, and his son against his father. A mother against her daughter, and a daughter against her mother. A mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and a daughter-in-law against her mother. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you, Deacon Dick and his wife Joan. I'm happy question so much as they say it as a blessing to one another as they go throughout the day. And I bring you that blessing from all of our sisters. Our home base is in Greensburg, Pennsylvania. I happen to serve as a hospital chaplain in Pittsfield, Mass. So this is one of the few times I've had a close place to go to. No planes, no two-day journeys. I get those elsewhere. The readings for today, there's a lot of wisdom in there for us to absorb, but I was struck by the thing, there's such a great cloud of witnesses for all of us. And these days, it's good for us to look around for the people of wisdom when there's so much trouble in the world. Elizabeth Ann Seton, and you may well know, as you're New Yorkers, she was from the city, very devout Episcopalian. Her mother died when she was 4. Her dad was very busy as a doctor with the immigrants coming into the States, not into the States yet, into the U.S. And she married William Seton, a handsome fella in his shipping business, and they had 5 children, and they also took in some other children who needed places to be. However, William had tuberculosis, and at that time the decision was to go, take an ocean voyage to be cured. And so she and Anna Maria, the oldest, went to Italy to the shipping partners, and unfortunately, 3 days after he was allowed off the ship, William died, leaving Elizabeth, a widow, with her daughter, other children at home. But the Filiki family that took her in were very devout Catholics. She had been a very devout Episcopalian, loved her scriptures and very prominent in her church. But she noticed that the Filikis had a chapel in their home, and every day they had Mass. And for Elizabeth, she suddenly understood when Jesus said, "This is my body, this is my blood," that he meant that it was a sacrament. And it was that interest and longing to be a person who could receive Eucharist that brought her back to her home in New York and wanting to become a Roman Catholic. Now, many of you know history better than I do, but that was not a good time to be a Catholic. They were poor, they were immigrants, and she was from the Anglican Church. So she would sit in the Anglican Church, which is still there. It's right here in sight of 9/11, the first body they took, Father Judge. They took them to that church. And she would look out the window at the steeple of the Catholic Church, which is still there, and say, "I think that's your real presence there, God." So it was that longing to be closer to Christ that brought her into Catholicism, lost family, lost friends as a result of that decision. But anyway, people gathered around her, as they had in her Episcopal Church, to do good things for other people. And more and more young women came to join Elizabeth. She eventually moved to Maryland and then down to Emmitsburg, which is, you've maybe been to the shrine there. But as New Yorkers, you need to remind yourselves, you've got the first American saints here. You're not off the hook. Try to be the second or the third. But for those of us who follow in her spirit, we have all had difficulties, as you have had difficulties, but ours were different. And in 1960, when I was a young sister, a bishop from Korea, South Korea, came and said, "You have a lot of sisters. We need sisters in South Korea, a very poor farming area." And for us, that was, all right, it's a call to a poor farming area. But to sisters, brothers, and priests in South Korea, they would lose face if they worked with them. And as Americans, we can have big egos, but we don't have the same understanding of losing face. And so about 100 sisters volunteered to go after they had a fight for an American community. She was an American. So but she wrote in her notebook, "I'm a citizen of the world." So I think, you know, she wants us to do this. So 4 of our sisters took a very slow boat to Korea, learning Korean language on the way over, getting ready to eat the kimchi, letting go of all their loved ones and their life in this country, And they knew what good missionaries know. God gets there before the missionary. And so their job was not specifically to proselytize. It was to live a life of love of God and faith. And there was no schooling for young girls and their mothers. And so they began a school, which before long had some 500 students. And many of those students, many were Buddhist, some became Christian, some became Catholics, and some, fortunately for us, became Sisters of Charity. And so I come on their behalf to share a little bit about that. We, pretty soon, they will have a school and a place for the blind, children who are deaf, multiply handicapped, and especially those on the autism Asperger spectrum. You may have family members, as I do now, have two, a new baby and an older fellow. Those children are incredibly creative and bright, but they need socialization, and our sisters seem to have a wonderful gift of working with those children and their families to help them find a place in life and use their gifts for the rest of us. If you ever get to Seoul, Korea, there's a wonderful bakery there that adults with Down syndrome who went to our school, they run that bakery. Haven't had a birthday cake and to get one for them. But we also had a home for runaway teenagers and for people from other countries, women who were kind of bought by Korean men to live with them and discovered that if you don't speak any of the same language, you don't know what to do with your mother or not. It's not going to be happy. And so we began to take in some of those women until they could get situated either back in their home or someplace safe. The people in Korea, when it was one, who escaped into China when the war increased, for some reason they have a very high incidence of autism and Asperger spectrum. And the Chinese government contacted our sisters and said, couldn't you come and help us, help our families know how to deal with it? And so, once again, four brave sisters who already knew Korean, English, learned Chinese, and went and are helping to educate people to know how to deal with these children who have gifts. We just need to untap them. And two of their sisters came to the convent where I was in Greensburg at the time, and the more they talked about it, the more their faces lit up. But they knew at any moment there could be a knock on the door and they would be sent out of China. They wear absolutely no religious garb, not our emblem, not our ring, but they do what they think God has called them to do, and we support them in that. And before long, we had a request from a Belgian priest and a Korean woman in Pedro Corvo, Ecuador. There were a lot of Koreans that had gone to that part of Ecuador. Couldn't we please send sisters? So once again, four sisters went to Ecuador, learned another language again, settled in, and it was a small school, not very well staffed or attended, and pretty soon the sisters began to train lay people to work with them. Again, they have children with multiple issues to deal with. And on the weekends, I was privileged to spend a couple of weeks working in Ecuador. I visited Korea four times, but for meetings or to give a presentation, not to actually live there. But the sisters on the weekends in Ecuador go out to the far out places, and it's very rural, and try to find a child who's been hidden away because the family was embarrassed by them, and find ways to bring them into school. So that school has grown a lot since I was there, but they're always in need of more teachers, more education. There was also, in my field, there was a very small hospital in Pedro Corvo because the maternal fetal death rate in that area was awful. And as daughters of Elizabeth Seton, who so loved her own children and encouraged us to be loving towards the children that we serve, they decided that they needed to try to do something about that too. So they bring those children in, and that healthcare facility has grown, so it now treats men, women, not just pregnant women. chickens. You know the chickens you buy at the supermarket? You know, it's going to feed how many? One chicken. We had two chickens for 60 people. And we had to pick that chicken beyond what I had ever done before. We had about 5 oranges to hand squeeze right up through the grind. So that was enough for lunch for everybody. So they're not living high on hog, but they're living in very loving ways, and I'm happy to help try to share that with you. So I would like to invite you to think about the missions in 3 ways. First, keep all missionaries in your prayer. The bishop invited my community to come here and to several other churches in the Albany Diocese, but there are lots of missionaries. We're in the Church of Saint Clare. I'm 1 of 6, public school taught. Number 4 was the only boy. He was a missionary in Brazil, a Franciscan. So Clare's, you know, like best friends with Saint Francis. And so happy to come to this church and make that connection with you. He served from the year after ordination in Brazil, and it will be 3 years since he died. He loved being a missionary. He thought he'd never be a priest. He couldn't give everything up. Couldn't give up the sports page and whether the Sox won last night or not. That was a high priority for him. And he discovered when God calls, there's going to be a lot of other things that help you out. So please pray for all missionaries, because some orders probably didn't get invited to come to Albany, but they also need our prayers. And if you can offer any financial support, nothing is too small. In Arizona, they had a quarter campaign, and they put a bowl by the school and the church, and people dropped quarters in. You'd be surprised how those quarters can add up when you've only got 2 chickens and 5 oranges to feed 60 people. So you may win the lottery, and maybe you can bet on some good horse. If you have a half a million that you want to share, we would not say no to that. But I'm not here to ask that. I'm here to ask whatever little thing you can offer, that would be most appreciated. And thirdly, we heard about Jeremiah, and God calls all of us. So as I've been out and about, it's not just Abraham and Paul and Elizabeth Seton, but God calls all of us. And I'm looking out here, and there's some young people here, and there's some middle-aged people, and then some of us are octogenarians. But none of us are off the hook. If God has something he'd like us to help with, guess what? He's going to keep knocking or pulling on you or talking in your ear. So the church needs all of us now. We don't have many priests, we don't have many sisters, we don't have many brothers, but we've got the people of God. So I would encourage you not to dismiss a call that you might feel deep down, some way to serve the church. So with that, I want to end with sharing a poem written by a young Korean woman who's unable to use her arms or her legs. Sister asked them to draw a picture and to write a story. She drew a picture with her foot, and then she entitled her poem, Hope. In the picture, I'm standing, but outside the picture, I'm always sitting down. In the picture, I'm eating something with my hands, but outside the picture, my hands are useless. In the picture, my hands and feet are separate, but outside the picture, my feet are my hands. But, I do believe someday I shall become what I am in the picture. Hope is the message of this child who would seem to have so much, you know, holding her back, but it's not. So my prayer is that you and I can try to live out hope wherever we are. We're called to live in freedom with God and to serve one another in love, and that's a challenge. And so I want to thank Father Kane and Deacon Dick and his wife and your bishop for inviting me to come and share with you. And I want to assure you of prayer of all of the Sisters of Charity, whether they're at the Mother House and they're 100 years old, or they're in Korea or China or Ecuador. We will be mindful of you, or whether we're in Pittsfield, Mass. So I say muchas gracias on behalf of those that speak Spanish, and kamsahamnida on behalf of those who speak Korean, and thank you. May God bless you and your loved ones.
In our second reading, we heard that we should keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the leader and perfecter of faith. Together we profess that faith, the same faith used by the missionaries in China, Korea, and Ecuador, with the Apostles' Creed. Together, I believe in God.
Accept our prayer, O Lord, which rises to you like burning incense in your sight. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Immense is the cloud of witnesses who surround us and who walk with us toward your kingdom. walking hand in hand with them toward the dawn of their mercy. Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Reminder that the second reflection will be for sister missions. Pray, sisters and brothers, that these gifts of bread and wine are monetary offerings for the missions, offered in a spirit of faith and love, may be acceptable to God and our life.
Amen.
face the heavenly banquet to come. With joy and thanksgiving, we raise up this prayer of gratitude to God. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, and eternal God, through Christ who is our Lord. For by his birth, he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering, canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead, he has opened the way to eternal life, and by ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so, with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end, your plan. Similar way, taking the chalice of blessing, filled with the fruit of the vine, Jesus gave thanks and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the chalice of the blood. The blood of the new and eternal covenant should be poured out for you and for the many for the forgiveness of sins." Then he said to them, "Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, Lord, as we now celebrate the memorial of our redemption, we remember Christ's death and his descent to the realm of the dead. We proclaim his resurrection and his ascension to your right hand. And as we await his coming in glory, we offer you his body and blood, the sacrifice acceptable to you that brings salvation to the whole world. Look, O Lord, upon the sacrifice which you yourself have provided for your church, and grant in your loving kindness to all partake of this one bread and one chalice, that gathered into one body by the Holy Spirit, that may truly become a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Therefore, Lord, remember now all of whom we offer this sacrifice, especially your servant Francis, our Pope, and your Archbishop, our Archbishop Emeritus, the whole order of bishops, all the clergy, the religious, those who take part in this offering, those gathered here before you, your entire people, and all who seek you with a sincere heart. Remember also those who have died in the peace of the Christ, especially as remember the prayer of the faithful and all the dead, whose faith you honor by you. To all of us, your children, grant our blessing for life, that we may enter into heavenly inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, your spouse, with your apostles, Saint Elizabeth and Seton, Saint Clare, and all saints of your kingdom. There, with the whole creation, free from the corruption of sin and death, may we glorify you in Christ our Lord, through whom we bestow our Lord, and with his good. You, Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever and ever. Deliver us, O Lord, from every evil, especially glory. eyes fixed on Jesus, who leads and perfects our faith. He endures the cross and the opposition of sinners, who conquered all sin. Blessed are we to be invited to the banquet of the Lamb. deacon says finally, and I always get the last word. I invite you to turn to your evangelist, page 16. It's a very nice picture of our deacon Dick Fieser and his wife Joan. There's a fundraiser going on at the firehouse across the street from our church. It's going on to 7 o'clock this evening. It'd be a nice community thing to stop there on the way home and support our member of the fire department. The Lord be with you.
Let us bow our heads and pray for God's blessing.
May Almighty God always keep every adversity far from you, and in his kindness pour out upon you the gifts of his blessing.
And let the church say,
Amen.
God, keep your hearts attuned to his words, that they may be filled with everlasting gladness.
And let the church say,
Amen.
And so, may you always understand you as good and right, and be found ever easily along in the path of God's commandments, made co-heirs with the citizens of heaven.
And let the church say,
Amen. Amen.